The topic of discussion is there is safety or more safety. May I request our Bhatia to deliver his speech.
Thank you very much for including this invitation to speak in a plenary session. And today I am going to present on safety first. The most dangerous phrase in the language is, we have always done it this way. And I will be speaking for next 20 minutes on, there is safety in more safety. I bring greetings from Sarganaram Hospital and Bhatia Global Hospital and Endosurgery Institute. I'm sorry to start on a negative note. This is a cemetery. And in this it is written, Mr. So-and-so, Deputy Superintendent of Police has died because of the negligence of Dr. So-and-so of this hospital. Similarly, one of the funeral ceremonies of a person, they are carrying this banner that this person has died because of the negligence of Dr. So-and-so of this hospital. What I mean to say, one move can start a movement. And we had all over the world, I would not say only in India, but all over the world, doctors are beaten or there are fines and so many things are occurring. As Dr. Majid had also presented very nicely about the legal aspects, most important is the teamwork. You can see this Formula One racing car driving, it just takes 0.1 second or 1 second, and ultimately the four tires are changed, fueling is done, and it goes. So if any of the member of the team says, sorry sir, I could not tighten the tire, and the pilot dies. So same way, ultimately, it is not the question of only the surgeon, it is a question of teamwork. And one of the person, Senna, had died in Formula One racing car, but the president of the Association of Formula One Racing Car decided that day, this kind of young death would never ever occur on a track. If they can see, and they have done so much for last so many years, that none of the pilot, none of the car drivers are dying on that high racing car tracks, then why can't we think that failure is not an option? When we do the surgeries, our younger colleagues should tell us that today I have given my best and you cannot cut one mark out of my operation. In God we trust, all others must bring data. Can you imagine the global burden of death, if one can see? The post-operative death comes third after the ischemic heart disease and the stroke. What I mean to say, none of the death certificates has the comment that he or she has died because of the negligence of the doctor or the hospital or some medication error. But still, the post-operative death amount to 7.7% of the total deaths. Similarly, total surgical procedures which are done world over are 313 million and total deaths within 30 days is 4.2 million. That means 7.7% of all the deaths. And in the first 30 days, more people die from surgery rather than totaling from malaria, HIV and tuberculosis combined. Can you imagine? If we take the opportunity to tell that yes, we are developing countries, in developed countries also approximately 44,000 to 98,000 Americans die in a hospital as a result of care which we are providing. And the complications after surgery are occurring in 25% of the patients, and after major surgeries, crude mortality rate is of the order of 0.5 to 1%. But the facts about surgical safety is that half are related to surgical care and half are preventable. Only thing is, one has to have that attitude that we are going to give the best to the patient. And 3 to 4% are harmed by the care which are supposed to give, and 7%, can you imagine that, 7% are exposed to a serious medication error, and that ultimately destroys. There was a survey, and it was published nicely in Archives of Surgery, that wrong side surgery in the plastic surgeons, I am just showing you the extremes of surgery, wrong side surgeries, 1500 to 2500 each year in US, and 21% of more than 1000 hand surgeons reported at least once they have done a wrong side surgery. As simple as hand, the wrong side things are done. Recently there was a paper in last week only in New York, they have transplanted a kidney into a wrong patient. So what I mean to say, you can imagine the state of affairs, you can imagine that the science of safety has matured, and basically what is the cause? We should introspect within ourselves, what is the cause of this? And cause is communication breakdowns, diagnostic errors, poor judgment, and inadequate skill. So most important is that it has been defined also that whether there is an error of omission or commission, or there is an error of execution, planning, or there is a deviation from the process of care which is responsible for causing these kind of things. Can you imagine? What anyone can guess? What is this? This is because of the mask. The mask had been applied, it was not properly ETO'd, and then you can see the chemical reaction which has occurred. So don't practice until you get it right. Practice until you can't get it wrong. That is the concept, and the decisions are more important than incisions. We always tell our fellows in Sir Gangaram as well as in Global Hospital that incision, and most important is a split second becomes an eternal, that even if surgeon's attention is deviated for a few seconds, then the chances of causing an injury are higher. Our thinking is, today when I take a flight from New Delhi to Bangladesh, I don't ask who is the pilot today. But any patient, as he was also mentioning, any patient has the right and has the instinct to ask who is the surgeon who is going to operate. That means we have not made it as safe as the aviation model is. When the pilot goes in, it is written that flying is a serious profession. Do not carry your worries beyond this point. But we are carrying all our worries into the theater, and we are watching the match and still doing the laparoscopic surgery. Can you imagine? Distractions lead to disasters. I am so sorry, painful for me, when I see the surgeons talking on mobile phone with their family members and the patient is under spinal anesthesia and they are operating. So I don't think that what will be going in the mind of the patient. And you would have seen this, that the Jet Airways had taken a flight from Mumbai to London, and on the way the pilot had gone onto the toilet, but the co-pilot changed the frequency from 132.980 to 890, just a small. And yesterday also when we were doing a workshop in Dhaka Medical College, then again in hernia surgery, one of my assistants, he was saying, sorry sir, sorry sir, sorry sir. I said, no, there is no role of sorry in our care. We have to give our best. If a small mistake of 0.980 versus 0.890 occurs, the German, when it was flying over the German airspace, they flew the airplane, the planes, to shoot that plane because it had gone out of the radar, and it was causing, as he thought, as it is a UFO, unidentified flying object. But by the time the flights were there, three planes were there across along with the Jet Airways, then the pilot came back from the toilet, and he found that there was a loss of communication. It was not communicating with the radar, with the ATC, and ultimately changed back the frequency, and then they landed safely at London Airport. What I mean to say is, one small mistake, one split second can become eternal. One small mistake, if we do carry on making the mistakes every day, you can see if we are going extra care, we are doing this. If you are doing one small mistake less, then obviously this is the mathematics. So thinking is that most of us have been taught, especially for laparoscopic surgery, that it is the first puncture itself that causes risk. But this is not a new information. This was given by Jacobius. But till date, we are having injuries because of the venous leak, because of the trocar. Why can't we think that we have to be absolutely safe? Safety first should be ingrained into the minds of the surgeons. To err is human, to refer is divine. To err is human, to cover it up is unpardonable. Most of us are on a denial mode. And we carry on thinking and blaming our youth junior surgeons that if the errors are because of the other juniors rather than us. Misdiagnosing is a negligence and mismanaging is a crime. And according to us, all entries, all exits in laparoscopic surgery, for example, must be shown by the cameraman. And defects more than 10 millimeter or more must always be closed, because if we do not close it, for example, this is one of the patients. She had the sleeve gastrectomy, and after the sleeve gastrectomy, she presents 2 days after, and she has repeated vomiting. The surgeon starts thinking that why repeated vomiting? But can you imagine? This is the state of affairs of the intestine, and what would have happened? When the surgeon, the main surgeon, goes off, the junior surgeons just take off the cannula without seeing. If you see, take off the cannula, the air, the pneumoperitoneum ultimately makes sure that it is getting distracted into the wound, and that can lead on to so much of disaster. Our thoughts are that the greatest lessons are usually learned at the worst times and from the worst mistakes. And life is too short to learn from your own mistakes. Try to learn from others' mistakes too. Today also, would you be surprised that these kind of situations are happening? The appendectomy was done, and after appendectomy, the patient continued to have fever. The thorough investigation had been done, but they were stepping up the antibiotic every day and every day. But nobody, the surgeon was in a denial mode that nothing can go wrong. This is because of the appendectomy, because of the appendicitis, the patient is having fever. But when we got the CT scan done, and when we went in with laparoscopy, what you can see, it is not a surprise. This is a retained foreign body after open appendectomy. And we do such, all of us, I would not say that only I am doing, all of us do so much of such kind of service. I would put it this way, that this kind of mob, if one has played in open surgery, open appendectomy, where is the level of safety? That means we are not check, recheck, cross-check, counter-check, check and check. We are not checking with the staff. And if we are not making a habit of checking and rechecking with the staff, then obviously we are leading on to disasters. Our thinking is that these kind of protocols should be developed so that we have an attitude that surgery is an attitude, it is failure, is not an option. Please get out of your own way. If we start thinking within ourselves that I am responsible for the safety of the patient, then only one can make a small step, and that can change the life. And how will we make the change? What are the remedies, as he was mentioning? Continuous improvement through introspection, and that is called as Kaizen. Every minute, every time, we should think that yesterday and today and tomorrow, I have to be better than myself rather than anyone else. And that is called as Kaizen. To be good, anticipate one step. To be great, anticipate three steps. And if our assistants also are knowing this, that when the why is clear, the how is easy, so there will be a safety. How to attain this safety first? There have been, for example, checklists. I will be talking about checklists in a few moments. In, for example, thromboembolism. And she was talking about the colorectal surgery. We do a lot of robotic bariatric surgery. Many surgeons are not even giving the prophylaxis for thromboembolism. But you see, the mortality rate after the thromboembolism is of the order of 73%. This will occur after the discharge. And actual incidence is unreported. 8 out of the 10 autopsies in bariatric surgery are because of the thromboembolism. And if we still say that my patients have never died, they have been ambulated, they have been giving stockings and that's it, no. Our thinking is that if we can quantify the failures, if we can quantify the success by using these kind of Caprini-Skrohr models and then give the DVT profile exists accordingly, scientifically, evidence-based, then only will be able to save those kind of lives. Even if one person dies after this kind of surgery, of robotic or bariatric surgery, then we had it. So our thoughts are that we should make sure that all the patients are given extreme utmost care, then only there should be a safety and more safety. A mistake repeated more than once is a decision. Most of the time, yesterday also, again and again I am re-emphasizing, carried on telling me, sorry sir. No, but basic thought is, a mistake repeated more than once is a decision. And I would urge my younger colleagues to read this book by Atul Gawande from New York. He's a neurosurgeon from New York, and the Checklist Manifesto. And they have realized, and the NATM also had reported, that checklist was found to reduce the rate of post-operative complications and death by more than one-third. The checklist which we give back, which we had in the theater yesterday also, it does not mean that it should be stuck only on the wall, but it should be practiced day in and day out according to our kind of situations. And most important is read back, hear back error. For example, these two flights, I'm just comparing with the aviation model, these two flights were facing each other. This pilot had given the indication to ATC also, and they had given the reply to SpiceJet flight, but the SpiceJet pilot did not read back the same information which he had got. But after some time, they realized it. And every time, if we are telling any, giving any instruction to our younger colleague or a OT technician, we should make sure the instruction is proper and it is read back also, it is heard back also, then only the chances of causing any injury will be reduced. So similarly, communicate, as Dr. Majid was also presenting a nice presentation on communicate, over-communicate. And if we have the habit of making these kind of checklists for our own selves, not for anyone, but for our own selves, then we will be able to do the justice to the patient. We will be giving the maximum benefit to the patient. There are no mistakes, only lessons. So we should carry on learning lessons. And most important, disability in life is a bad attitude. And the will must be stronger than the skill. Most important is, yes, skill all of us can acquire. We can do sleeve gastric bypass and so on and so forth. But if we have the will that we are going to be absolutely safe for the patient, that only will make the difference. That will only make the difference in our young generation, in our generation who is going to operate on us. So if they do not learn the proper lessons, if they are not having that kind of attitude of taking care of every small step, then they will, if they are operating us tomorrow, they will be committing the same mistakes tomorrow. So our thinking is that we should be selfish enough to train them so well that they are doing the best operation when we require it, rather than on others also. So the will must be stronger than the skill. And most important is, no one can motivate you if you are not willing to do it for yourself. Again and again, I must thank the Society of Surgeons of Bangladesh for remembering me. Again and again, I have been to Vadham Hospital, to Square Hospital, to other hospitals for doing the workshop. And I honestly, when Dr. Humayun Kabir, Dr. Naeem, they phoned me. So I said, yes, I am. It is my second home, and I would love to come again and again just to meet my brothers. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. 10 minutes left. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your very